Hi, it's me, Robinson again. It has been quite some time that I have not recording any video discussing all the national issues, but today I think it's very important for me to say a few words on an issue that I think everybody is talking about, that is the passing away of the Sarawak Chief Minister, Tan Sri Adenan Satim. He passed away at about 1:20 p.m. today due to heart failure. For those who are following closely the development of Sarawak politics for the past 1 year, you must be very much aware that the health of the Chief Minister was not very good, especially after the election campaign. If you can refresh your memory, I think throughout the 2 weeks campaign in the state elections in mid-2016, he had to take 1 day off from his campaign trail to take a rest, and that I think was a very clear signal that at the point of time his health was not very good. What kind of person? Many people are actually phrasing Adenan Satim. I think the most outstanding performance that he has been showing to the people was he was actually one of the most daring chief minister or menteri besar among all the Barisan Nasional state governments, who is brave enough to sing a different tune from the federal government. There are many reasons why he is doing that. I think one of the reasons that he is capable to do that was he is not from the UMNO party. He is from the PBB. And UMNO has always been, this is an open secret, wanting to establish themselves in the state of Sarawak, but because of the previous Chief Minister Tan Mamo and also Adenan Satim, UMNO is unable to do that. And because of this, it is also an open secret that there are certain level of competitions between UMNO and PBB, between the federal government dominated by UMNO, dominated and led by Najib Razak, and the state government dominated and led by previously Dai Mamo and now Adenan Satim, and subsequently Adenan Satim. In fact, after the 2011 state elections, when Barisan Nasional lost badly in the state elections to PKR and DAP, there were already calls for the then Chief Minister Dai Mamo to step down. And he, of course, cannot step down just like that. He has to arrange somebody that he can trust, somebody from within PBB that he can trust. Trust in the sense that the government that this newcomer lead will be a government that is that will continue his policy, who will also be able to stand up to the pressure and the discriminations from the federal government. At that point of time, there were actually three candidates. All of them were from PBB. Alfred Jabu was out of questions. The three candidates that they were talking about is Abang Jo, Awang Denga, and also Adenan Satim. And subsequently, Adenan Satim was chosen as the person who will be replacing Tan Mamo. He has given everybody a brief of a fresh air. I did say it in the state elections openly in Ceramah that Malaysians, including Sarawakians, tends to believe in good man politics, good guy politics, instead of good governance, instead of good system. And Adenan, although he was a good man, because he is daring enough to stand up against the federal government on many, many issues. But nevertheless, he was still operating under the structure of Barisan Nasional, and there are limitations to what he can do, what he can say, and what he can achieve. Because being a state government, even though you are running a state government in Sabah, Sarawak, even though you have certain level of autonomy, but the most important thing is that the finance is still under the control of the federal government. And if you are relying heavily from the federal government on development, on infrastructures, I believe you won't be able, you will need to do a lot more discussions, you know, negotiations rather than confrontations with the federal government. Now, Adenan Satin, now, I say that many people love him, but if you want me to give a fair comment, I would say he is just another chief minister who is the most daring chief minister to stand up against federal government, that's all. And if you look at some of the, in fact, many people like him. I know the media from West Malaysia, whether they are printed media or electronic media, whether they are online or mainstream, I think they have some certain level of respect or love for Adenan Satin. But I have a different opinion. I believe he's just another chief minister. The only outstanding thing that he has done was because he is daring enough to do or to say something that is not in tune or in line with what the federal government want. And one of the reasons why he can do that is because he is not from UMNO. He's not within the structure of UMNO. He's from Parti Bumi Putra Bersatu. He has been chief minister. He had, in fact, he was only chief minister in 2014. Until today, he had not served the state as chief minister for one full 5 years. I think because of the limitations that he had, there are many U-turns that he made. I have listed down a few, and I think one of the very apparent U-turns that he made was the positions of the deputy chief minister, which he had openly promised to SUPP Sim Kui Hian in Ancharama if Dr. Sim could win the state seats of Patukawa. Eventually, Dr. Sim won the seat, but he was not given the positions of deputy chief minister, and that was actually the first U-turn that he made. One of the biggest U-turn that he made. Of course, the second U-turn he made, remember a few years ago, he tabled a motion in the state assembly to demand the state government, to demand the federal government in providing 20% royalty, oil royalty to the state government. That motion was passed in the state assembly, and when he was tabling and the motion, everybody was very excited. Yeah, the state government is going to do something about it. We have a chief minister who are daring enough to speak up against the federal government in protecting the rights and privileges of the Sarawakians. But after 1 or 2 years, the motion was passed in the state legislative assembly. What happened to the motion? Nothing has actually happened. In fact, the chief minister, Tan Sri Adenan, once upon a time said that they still need to discuss and negotiate with the federal government, and it will be something that is not going to happen overnight. Does that mean that it's not going to happen anytime sooner? So if that's the case, then there's a question of whether there was actually a U-turn made when initially the state government was very much determined to demand this 20%, and that was happening before the state elections. All in a sudden, after the state election, everything becomes very, very quiet. Not the second. This is the second issue. Third issue: recognitions of the Unified Examination Certificate (UEC). Adenan Satin has been very consistent on this. He has even demanded the state government to negotiate with the federal government on it. But unfortunately, nothing much he can do because I think when he realized that there is limitations to what the state government can do in terms of educations, in terms of tertiary educations. Then I would believe it's a kind of a U-turn that he made, because when he promised to recognize the UEC, there is a very high expectation that the only state-run university in Sarawak, that is UNIMAS, will open its enrollment to the UEC holder, particularly Sarawakian UEC holders, graduated from the local Chinese Independent High School. unfortunately, this is not happening, and the federal government has put out a very stern and strong stand on it that they are not going to recognize the UEC, and because UNIMAS is under the purview of the federal government, so there will be no enrollment for a UEC holder. So this is indeed, I think, another blow to the expectations of many Sarawakians. Local Sarawakian in Petronas were once upon a time being retrenched. And there was rumors that they were retrenched in big numbers. Positions of Petronas in Sarawak, supposedly held by Sarawakians, but the positions were taken out, and these Sarawakians were retrenched. How true it is, I'm not too sure. But I think when this news was reported in the media, Adenan Satem arranged a meeting, face-to-face meeting with the federal government. And of course, once again, he was perceived to be very determined to defend and protect the jobs opportunity of his fellow Sarawakians. But eventually, we don't know what happened until today. We are not sure whether jobs were restored. We are not sure whether Sarawakians who lost their jobs previously, whether they are re-employed by Petronas. This is, I think, another question that we have not received any answer. So based on all these things, I believe, I wouldn't say Tan Sri Adenan Satin was a remarkable leader because of these U-turns that he had made. And if you look at the development of Sarawak politics, it is very much a kind of competition between the federal government and state government, as I said just now. I said earlier that there were three candidates to replace Adenan Satem, to replace Taib Mahmud. Adenan Satem, Abang Joe, and Awang Tengah. Abang Joe was not selected. Because one of the reasons why he was not selected was he was perceived to be too close to the federal government, too close to Najib, too close to UMNO, too close to Putrajaya. He was not selected, but you look at what happened after the state elections in 2016. He was appointed as a deputy chief minister. Adenan Satem was appointed as the chief minister in 2014, replacing Taib Mahmud, very much because Taib Mahmud wants him and believe in him, trusted him that he will be a person who will continue his legacy and his policy. This is a person that he can believe who will stand up against the tyranny of the federal government. Now, Adenan Satem has passed away. So you're left with, I think, probably between Abang Joe or Awang Tengah. Awang Tengah is a so-so kind of candidate. I'm not sure whether he's pro federal government or pro Sarawak PBB. But looking at the trend that Abang Joe is now appointed as the deputy chief minister after the 2016 state elections, I have a feeling that the competitions between the federal government and the state government in determining the candidate who will be replacing Adenan Satem as chief minister will be intensified. Taib Mahmud is still around, he is a TYT, but the influence of Najib Razak is strengthening in Sarawak. And I believe he was even more daring to do that, even after the state elections. There are certain things that I think, if you are aware about, that actually send some signals that Najib Razak is prepared to put out a very strong stance against some of the regionalist Sarawakian politicians. Regionalist in the sense that a lot of people are pro protecting the rights and privileges of Sarawak. They support Sarawak for Sarawakians. What are these examples? You remember after when Muhyiddin was sacked from the federal cabinet, there was a reshuffle. And in this reshuffle, the numbers of Sarawakian federal minister was reduced. Adenan Satin at that point of time put up a very strong stand against it. But Najib Razak pulled along it and go through it and did not backtrack. He continued with the new reshuffle and the numbers of Sarawakian federal minister was reduced. Douglas Unga, before the state election, was the federal minister. During the state elections, he contested a state seat. He won the state seat and he was appointed as the deputy chief minister, another deputy chief minister, replacing Alfred Jabu. He resigned from the federal minister. By right, that position, that vacancy in the federal government should be replaced by the same Sarawakian minister, by another minister or another MP from Sarawak. That was not done. Eventually making Sarawakian has one minister position less from the previous arrangement. Pan Borneo Expressway, everybody was very happy in Sarawak. 16 billion project. But eventually what happened after state elections? Originally it was understood that this project will be treated as an extra project with extensional or extra funding from the federal government. That means what? The annual grant from the federal government to the Sarawak state government to fund all the other small and minor infrastructure projects, for example, building bridges, roads, street lights, so on and so forth, will not be affected. I give you, say for example, 100 ringgit every year for infrastructure development. I will also continue giving you this amount, and on top of that, you have one extra project and with additional funding from the federal government. That was the understanding before state elections. You know what happened after state election? The federal government told the Sarawak state government, told Adenan Satin straight to his face that, no, I give you 100 ringgit for infrastructure, that 100 ringgit, Pan Borneo Expressway is included in it. So if you want additional funds to build your roads, to build your bridges, to build any other infrastructure project that is not related to Pan Borneo, I'm sorry, there will be no more funding for it. You have to leave it what you have. So there's no solutions to this problem. The last that I heard from the media was that the Sarawak state government was not happy and they will continue to negotiate with the federal government in securing more additional funds for Sarawak. They need Pan Borneo Expressway. There is no doubt about it. But they cannot afford to have one Pan Borneo Expressway at the expense of all the other small and minor projects in the kampong, in the longhouses. They also need those kind of projects in the longhouses to serve the rural area. But all of a sudden, this arrangement was no longer in existence. The whole state was jumping up and down. What does this mean? It means that the federal government, under the leadership of the prime minister, who is also the first finance minister, may not tolerate the demand from the state government anymore. And you can see that there is some kind of competition between the federal government led by UMNO and the state government led by PBB. So it will be very interesting for the next 6 months, what will happen in Sarawak? Will the competitions to become the next chief minister intensify? Whether Najib is going to plan his own proxy from PBB to be the chief minister, and whether Tahir Mahmud will insist on his own person, or whether the two of them will come to a kind of agreement, we are not sure yet. Both of them have scandals. Will Najib be on the upper hand? Because the federal government controls a lot of agencies, the attorney generals, the police, and also the MACC. So these are all very interesting questions. And I believe there will be some kind of confusions, there will be some kinds of competitions And let's see what will happen in the next 6 months. And I believe one of the very important things that we in the opposition should do is to strengthen our positions and continue our ground services to the people, particularly Impian Sarawak. We cannot give up our project just like that. We have a promise to carry out, even though we lost badly in the rural areas, but we should not neglect them just because we lost in the state elections. So until then, I believe we should keep a close eye on the political development in Sarawak after the passing away of Adenan Satem. But of course, last but not least, I would like to express my deepest condolences to the family of Adenan Satem. I hope in difficult times like this, the families will be able to pull through whatever challenges that is lying ahead in front of them. So thank you for watching. Until then, goodbye and see you. Thank you.